Well, fact, fiction, spin, or substance, a growing number of media outlets and news organizations are putting a higher premium on fact-checking. It may be producing some results. Joining me to talk about the tricky waters of fact-checking in New York, Kathleen Hall Jamieson, professor of communication at the University of Pennsylvania, director of the school's Annenberg Public Policy Center, and creator of factcheck.org. With me in the studio, John Sides, associate professor of political science at George Washington University, and author of the Monkey Cage blog, and Ginger Gibson, congressional reporter for Politico. John, I want to start with you. New report looking at this fact-checking, whether it has any impact. What's it say? What do you conclude?
It's the first ever real-world fact-checking experiment. 1,200 state legislators in 9 different states were divided into different groups. And one of those groups was sent a series of letters that said, there's a PolitiFact affiliate in your state now. And it outlined the kinds of things that might happen if PolitiFact were to catch you saying something untrue. And then the researchers, Brendan Nyhan and Jason Reifler, went and looked to see how many of these legislators had actually said something that either PolitiFact or local media said was in fact half true or worse, all the way down to pants on fire.
And what'd they find?
They found that the legislators who had gotten these letters warning them that PolitiFact might do this to them were less likely to make inaccurate statements than legislators who didn't get this letter.
Oh my goodness, so maybe it works. Well, Kathleen Hall Jamieson, as I ask you this question, I want to put up factcheck.org. Factcheck.org has become a commanding presence in the political process throughout the presidential campaigns. It's prompted response from some. What evidence do you have that factcheck.org has had any impact on the facts as engaged by our political leaders?
In the 2012 presidential campaign, Governor Romney made a claim about how many jobs net he had created while he was at Bain Capital. He was pushed back by all the fact checkers who didn't see the evidence to justify the claim, and he modified the claim. The Obama campaign was arguing that Romney had outsourced while he was at Bain. He was pushed back by the fact checkers, and they changed the claim to say Romney's firm, Bain, had outsourced. That would be after Romney had given up day-to-day control of operations. It doesn't happen often, but it tends to happen when all the fact checkers agree, they stay on it, and representatives from the campaign are asked about it when they come on programs such as CNN.
Ginger Gibson, you're up on Capitol Hill for Politico reporting. When the bomb actually lands, right, and someone's called a liar, they fail, Glenn Kessler, Washington Post, the Pinocchio test, he puts up the 2 or 3 or 4 Pinocchios after he fact-checks someone, somebody go running out of the congressional office with their pants on fire?
No, but their press secretaries, when it's the other guy who's called out, will blast out those as a press release.
And I mean, what do you do with that?
Most of the time, ignore them.
You ignore it?
I mean,
Wait a minute. So if someone's called a liar or is exposed to a fact check, and you're the reporter up there, you ignore that?
Well, I mean, we ignore it when it becomes political fighting, right? It becomes the other guy using it against the other.
But if someone is objectively wrong... Right.
As a reporter who covered the campaign and covers the Hill now, these fact checks are great for us because sometimes when the claim keeps getting repeated, we can point to them in a story and say, look, they've been deemed untrue by multiple fact checkers. And I think that line is important, the multiple fact checkers. When it's multiple fact checkers agreeing, we can go to that. And that's how we use it. That's how we call attention to things that if we're not doing the fact checking, but we know not to be true, we can call.
John Sides, you've done a lot of work on political polarization in Washington now, and your work has shown that we're as polarized or more so than we've been in a very long time, perhaps since the Civil War, right? There are issues of polarization even in fact-checking. Who do you fact-check? Who decides? What metrics do you use and what sources do you use to decide whether someone's pants are on fire or not?
I think the one thing that first needs to happen is that a lot of the garden variety kinds of misinformation probably should just be ignored. I think the real challenge is that when that kind of misinformation gets news coverage, it only gives incentives to politicians to continue to do this kind of stuff. It's the really big issues, the kind of chronic kinds of misinformation about the president's birthplace, about what's in the Affordable Care Act and what's not in the Affordable Care Act. These are the kinds of issues that really need the media to bird dog them and fact check them on a regular basis.
Kathleen Hall Jamieson, I came on this program probably about a year ago because over at George Washington University, we started something called Face the Facts USA. I'll put a picture up of that. And the idea here was not to call people out and say, you're wrong, but rather to put out facts where we knew there was a lot of confusion. Because some of the social science actually shows that people are not inclined to take a fact check where you're waving your finger and saying this candidate or this political leader is wrong. You might process information if it were coming from a trusted source without the finger wagging. What do you make of that?
I agree with that as a perspective, and good journalism does that. It creates a context for viewing information. Much of what's said in politics isn't blatantly factually inaccurate. It's misleading. It requires a context. Sometimes it's deliberately taken out of context. And as a result, it requires contextual journalism. Good journalism does that well. Your program does that well. We also know that there's a way to fact check that increases the likelihood that you hear the correction. You hear the correction if you can reframe up front and you can meta-communicate. We have a second site called Flack Check that tries to do that with humor.
What does meta-communicate mean?
You're talking about the communication, so you're not inside the frame of the visual itself. We deal largely with ads. If you put the offending ad up on the screen and you create a visual structure that puts the context on top of that, the likelihood that the individual processes the deception before the correction goes way down. And we know that from a study we did in 2012, when people say they've gone to the fact-checking sites in the presence of controls, they get the answers to those questions about the deceptions more accurate than they did otherwise. That's okay. An important finding. It was statistically significant.
Ginger, very, very quickly to you, in 10 seconds. Neil Newhouse, famously a Romney pollster, last time said, we're not going to let our campaign be dictated by fact-checkers. Is that a theme you hear from other offices on the Hill as you cover?
It is. They think that they make the case that they're biased, that they're slanted, that they were done out of spite, and that they, even if they're deemed completely to be out of line with the truth, they're just going to ignore them.
Well, let's just hope it's a movement to come. And I've got something, a little product placement here. Snapple, you know they do the facts at the top. I'm going to read this one. It's, some violins contain 70 separate pieces of wood. Well, you'll be glad to know that there are folks out there now that are fact-checking the Snapple real facts. So there you have it. Maybe it's a movement. Kathleen Hall Jamieson, John Sides, and Ginger Gibson, thank you all very much for joining us on Reliable Sources.